Come on.
Break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain.
Thank you. This morning we're going to start off with Peace Like a River.
I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got love like the ocean, I've got love like the ocean, I've got love like the ocean in my soul. I've got love like the ocean, I've got love like the ocean, I've got love like the ocean in my soul. I've got joy like the fountain, I've got joy like a fountain, I've got joy like a fountain in my soul. I've got joy like a fountain, I've got joy like a fountain, I've got joy like a fountain in my soul. I've got peace like a river, I've got love like the ocean, I've got joy like a fountain in my soul. I've got peace like a river, I've got love like the ocean, I've got joy like a fountain in my soul.
Okay, we're going to sing another one about rolling the gospel chariot along.
Roll the gospel chariot along. Roll the gospel chariot along, roll the gospel chariot along, and we won't tag along behind. If my brother's in the way, we will stop and pick him up. If my brother's in the way, we will stop and pick him up. If my brother's in the way, we will stop and pick him up, and we won't tag along behind. Roll the gospel chariot along. Roll the gospel chariot along. Roll the gospel chariot along, and we won't tag along behind. If my sister's in the way, we will stop and pick her up. If my sister's in the way, we will stop and pick her up. If my sister's in the way, we will stop and pick her up, and we won't tag along behind. Roll the gospel chariot along. Roll the gospel chariot along. Roll the gospel chariot along, and we won't tag along behind. If the devil's in the way, we will run right over him. If the devil's in the way, we will run right over him. If the devil's in the way, we will run right over him, and we won't tag along behind. Roll the gospel chariot along. Roll the gospel chariot along. Roll the gospel chariot along, and we won't tag along behind.
Good morning. Welcome to our home. I'm Mr. Hooper.
And I'm Mrs. Hooper.
We wanted to have a chance to talk to you this morning about gratitude. The last several weeks, a lot of us have been indoors quite a bit, and we've had a lot of opportunities, I'm sure, to show gratitude. Mom and Dad may have been working from home, and you've probably been doing your schoolwork from home on Zoom calls or whatever it is that you maybe have been on. And I'm sure it's produced a lot of opportunities for us to be able to show our gratitude. So wanted to talk a little bit about the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul actually spent some parts of his life a lot of times indoors, sometimes even in prison, but yet he still was grateful and he was thankful. In Philippians chapter 3, Paul was actually in prison and he was writing to his friends in Philippi. He said, I thank my God every time I remember you. He was thinking about his friends and he was grateful during that time. Somewhere else, Paul wrote in his first letter to the Thessalonians in chapter 5 or 16, it says, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Hmm. You know, there are different times, I'm sure, that we have spent over the last few weeks, and we can choose to be grateful no matter what the circumstances may be.
So one of the practical things that you can do is get a journal and decorate it and write at least three things that you are grateful for every day and be able to look back at this time and show and see how you grew in your gratitude. So our kids have had several opportunities to show their gratitude, and we're going to show you that right now.
I'm a little disappointed that special events that I had got canceled, but I am grateful for time spent doing things I love.
I really miss seeing my friends. But I'm grateful for all the baking I get to do. Yum. Time to do the dishes. Liam, Mommy says it's time for dinner.
What's for dinner?
Butternut squash soup.
But Mom worked really hard for it. Thank you, Mommy!
Well, thank you for joining us this morning. We're going to close out our time in a word of prayer.
Dear God, thank you for this day. Please help our healthcare workers to protect them and all those who are sick, just heal them and help us to remember gratitude. And we love you in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let's keep singing here this morning, worshiping God. is our God, and all will see how great is our God. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. Song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty God over all and blessed eternally. Holy, 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 though the darkness hide thee, though the eye of sinful men thy glory may not see, only thou art holy, there is none beside thee, perfect in power, in love and purity. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, all thy works shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God over all and blessed eternally. Let's keep singing this morning. Little Gimme Jesus.
In the morning when I arise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus. You can have all this world. Give me Jesus. I'm alone. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world. Give me to die. Oh, when I come to die, give me
no other king could vanquish the war horse or silence the warrior's rage while riding the lowly back of a donkey. No other king could break the dominion of darkness, the tyranny of evil, with a reign of grace and a kingdom of peace. No other king could give his life for the redemption of rebels, his wealth to welcome the outcast. Jesus is that King, the King of glory, Son of the living God. Not just another king, not just another prophet, not just another teacher. He was the one the world had been waiting for, the one to deliver us from captivity, the Son of David and Abraham's chosen seed. He is the goal of the Mosaic Law, Yahweh in the flesh. He is the one to establish God's reign and rule, to heal the sick, give sight to the blind, freedom to the prisoners, and proclaim good news to the poor. This Jesus was the Creator come to earth and the beginning of a new creation. He embodied the covenant, fulfilled the commandments, and reversed the curse. This Jesus is the Christ that God spoke of to the serpent, the one prefigured to Noah in the flood, the one promised to Abraham, the one guaranteed to Moses before he died, the one promised to David during his reign, the one revealed to Isaiah as a suffering servant, the one predicted through the prophets and prepared for through John the Baptist. He is the Father, Son, Savior of the world, and substitute for our sins. More loving, more holy, and more wonderfully terrifying than we ever thought possible. He is our Jesus, and there is no other king like him. He is our God, our glory, our victorious Savior. There is no other king like him. There is no other king.
Well, happy Easter. I'm grateful to be able to connect with all of you like this. And I know for all of you at home, thank you so much for taking the time to spend with us this morning. You know, as children, many of us would have these egg hunts that we'd go on Easter Sunday. Someone would take the time and they'd fill out plastic eggs, usually with candy or with cash, and these eggs would be hidden all around the house or even maybe in the backyard. And what we'd do is we'd spend time looking for them. You know, I remember one year we were with some friends and the eggs were scattered all over the lawn. And we were told that we can only grab like 10 eggs because there weren't going to be enough for everybody. And so we were told then after that that these eggs had candy in them, except a few of them. Some of them were filled with cash. And we didn't know the denominations of the cash, but all I could tell you is internally, I got super excited. And so the eggs, they took them and they placed them and they taped them shut so we wouldn't be able to sneak a peek. They hit them all over the yard, and then they yelled, "Go." And I remember kids just running around aimlessly. It was chaotic. And then I took off, and I remember going for the eggs and starting to shake them. Because if I heard a rattling in the egg, I knew there wasn't cash in that egg. So I'd place it down and I'd keep moving around till I found a better egg. I felt like I had a really good strategy on that. And you know, what I realized was I didn't care about any of the eggs that had candy in them anymore. I was willing to ignore everything else to find the most valuable eggs. You know, amongst a lot of the chaos right now, I feel like many of us are trying to discover what is most valuable to us in our lives. Maybe we're even trying to discover what our faith should look like under these new circumstances. You know, no matter where you're at, no matter where you're coming from, what we do have to remember most importantly is that because of the resurrection, we will always have hope among the chaos. And so that's what I want to get into a little bit today. So the title of my sermon this morning is Finding Easter. You know, we're going to be in Luke chapter 2 here in a moment. And there are two events I want to focus on today specifically. The first is boy Jesus at the temple. And the second deals with Joseph of Arimathea right after Jesus had died. And there's a common theme in both these stories that I want to shed light on. In each story, there were things going on that were seemingly chaotic. Yet in the end, God used both of the situations for his good. So we're going to read into it. Luke chapter 2 will be in verse 41. And in Luke 2, verse 41, it reads, "Every year, Jesus' parents went to Jerusalem for the festival of the Passover. When he was 12 years old, they went up to the festival according to the custom. After the festival was over, while his parents were returning home, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but they were unaware of it. Thinking he was in their company, they traveled on for a day. Then they began looking among the relatives and friends. When they did not find him, they went back to Jerusalem to look for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple courts, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. Everyone who heard him was amazed at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were astonished. His mother said to him, 'Son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you.' 'Why were you searching for me?' he asked. 'Didn't you know I had to be in my father's house?' But they did not understand what he was saying to them. Then he went down to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them. But his mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus grew in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man." You know, when I first read these stories, all I could think about was how horrible of parents Mary and Joseph were. Your kid is gone the whole day and you don't notice? See, when my kid leaves the room, we notice. Mostly because it gets really quiet and I know something bad's about to happen. How can you go a whole day not realizing your kid is gone? But you know, after understanding their situation a little bit more clearly, I realized it was very easy to lose their son in these conditions. See, when they would travel like this, they would travel in a big group, usually with extended family and friends, to avoid any anybody robbing them or anybody harming them. And so amongst the big group, it would have been very easy to get lost in the chaos. So let's put ourselves for a moment in the shoes of Mary and Joseph. They're being good parents, right? They're obeying the commands of God. In fact, in verse 41, it says, every year they made this trip to Jerusalem. This was a part of their life, was to go to Jerusalem. And so picture this. At least this is how I picture it. I can just imagine Mary and Joseph. They've left Jerusalem, and now they're on their way home. Then I can imagine Mary, after about a day, taking time to walk around the camp, and she starts counting heads, making sure she has everybody. She noticed someone's missing. And so I can see her going to Jesus' brothers and sisters and just asking, hey, have you seen Jesus? Have you seen your brother? And then you just hear him, no, we haven't seen him. I'm sure James pulled a, am I my brother's keeper? But we'll get back to that, right? But no, we haven't seen him. And then you could see Mary going to her husband, Joseph. Hey, hon, have you seen Jesus? Is he with you? And you just see Joseph replying, no, I haven't seen him either. And then you could just feel it, see it in Mary, this panic set in. Where is my son? And so now she's frantically running around the camp, waking people up. Have you seen Jesus? Everybody. No, when was the last time you've seen him? We haven't seen him since we left. And I could just imagine Mary in that moment being in tears because not only has she lost her oldest son, but she's just misplaced the Son of God. She's not having a good day, right? And so I could see Mary getting herself together going, look, here we go. We got to go back to Jerusalem. We've got to go find Jesus. And so they do. They race back to Jerusalem, and they begin to look all over the city for him. And here's what's shocking to me. For 3 days, they can't find him. You've got a big group, and for 3 days, you can't find him. I mean, where were you looking? Well, were you looking? Maybe you went and looked where you stayed while you were there. And sure enough, he wasn't there. Maybe you looked at like the local watering hole or you looked at the marketplace. Maybe he's in these places. Nope, he is not able to be found. 3 days go by, nothing. And then someone has the idea. Maybe we've looked everywhere else. Maybe he's in the temple courts. And it was at this point, Mary and Joseph take off and they run to the temple courts. They see Jesus talking to the elders and asking questions. And this is an incredible moment where they find their son. But you know, this story has me thinking. Many of us, at one point in our lives, finding ourselves frantically looking for Jesus, right? We feel lost. Maybe like Mary, we feel scared or panicked. As we're searching around for where Jesus might be, and he's not there. We go and we look in places that are comfortable to us, things that we think Jesus may be in because they're comfortable to us. And he's not there either. You know what I've realized is Jesus is always in the same place. He's in his Father's house. He's always there. He's waiting for us to come and be with him and sit with him and have a relationship with him. But that takes us running towards him. You know, getting back to the story, I have this image of Mary. She finds her son. She wraps her arms around him. And then she pushes him away and grabs him by the shoulders and starts shaking him. Why did you do this to me? Why did you make us so scared by leaving us? We looked everywhere, and you could just see in Mary this panic, this fear that she had inside of her. But it was at this moment where Jesus says something extremely profound. He says, didn't you know I had to be in my Father's house? Jesus' issue with his mom was she had just spent 3 days looking in the wrong place. He was upset that that Jesus' mom, Mary, was looking all over, but not where he knew he was supposed to be. So I've got a question. Where are you currently looking, hoping to find Jesus? Where are you currently looking, hoping to find Jesus? Would Jesus be miffed with you over the places you're searching for him right now? Would he be happy where you're looking? You know, I think we can make finding Jesus more difficult than it needs to be, honestly. But I will say, like we see in Mary, if we're going to find him, it will take urgency and it will take effort. You know, Mary's eagerness was eventually rewarded as her panic turned into a moment where she became more attentive to Jesus. It was at this point where the scripture tells us she learned to treasure all these things in her heart. Her seeking was rewarded. She learned that lesson. You know, going back to my egg story from where I began, you know, I remember taking a quick break as I ran around, running around as I saw how others were gathering their eggs. And I remember looking at the people with their baskets filled with eggs. They had collected their 10 and they were done. And it was at this moment that I began to worry. And I started asking the question, should I just start grabbing random eggs because I'm so far behind? Or maybe did they grab all the eggs with the money in them already and I've got no chance? And I started to worry and I started to think. And what I realized in that moment was all that worrying, all that thinking caused me to stop searching because I was so concerned about what everybody else was doing. You know, I think oftentimes on our journey to finding Jesus, we will be sidetracked by things that shouldn't bother us. We'll allow circumstances or even our environment to stop us from chasing God. But I think something that's important to remember is it's much easier to be swayed by emotions when we're trying to find God by ourselves. See, but if we have this foundation, right? If we have this community that we have in the church or with one another, it's more difficult for Satan to get a foothold and to distract you. So I want to encourage you with this. You're going to have to be creative now, but I want to encourage you to continue to find ways to connect with each other because right now is when we need each other more than ever before. Because worst case scenario, Satan's going to come in and he's going to get a hold of you and it's going to be very difficult to loosen that grip. So let's strive to run towards community. Amen. So the other story I want to look at takes place right before the resurrection. And that's in John chapter 19, and we'll read that in a second. The resurrection is the most important moment in history in the world. But see, before this joyous event even took place, there were a few days of darkness, and there were a few days of uncertainty. The apostles were feeling lost and abandoned and unsure, honestly, of what to do next. And it was in this chaos, in this darkness, in this uncertainty, where one disciple, not apostle, one disciple decided to remain faithful. John 19, verse 38 reads, "Later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Now, Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, because he feared the Jewish leaders. With Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who had earlier had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds. Taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it with spices and strips of linen. This was in accordance with the Jewish burial customs. At the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, in which no one had ever been laid. Because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there." So here's what's going on. Jesus is dead, and the apostles won't come claim the body. They're either feeling ashamed, or they're guilty, or they're scared. But in any case, they're nowhere to be found. I mean, think about how they must have been feeling, the apostles, at this moment. Everyone denied Jesus and fled. Peter, who's kind of the vocal leader, three times he swears he doesn't even know Jesus. And after that, he realizes what he's done, and he goes away crying after the rooster crows. Then you've got Judas, who's one of the 12, who's the group treasurer. He leads a rebellion. They arrest Jesus, and they kill him because of his testimony. So how does Judas reply? In his guilt and in his shame, he takes his own life. The apostles are in disarray. And this is the moment in which Joseph from Arimathea steps up. And so here's what we know about Joseph. One, he was a secret disciple. Two, Luke's account tells us that he was part of the ruling council that condemned Jesus. And the other thing that Luke makes sure to point out is even though he was on the council, he did not give a vote to kill Jesus. He didn't give in to the pressure of killing an innocent man. When the pressure was hitting Joseph hard, Luke says he remained faithful. So Joseph gets the body, and he brings Nicodemus, who was also a member of the Jewish ruling council, and together they did the unthinkable. They touched the dead body of a traitor. Numbers 19 tells us that doing this, touching the dead body, would have made them unclean. And this is what, at least for me, convicts me. They were willing to defile themselves for someone who their friends had just condemned to death for blasphemy. They were willing to make a decision to step out on faith even when it was unpopular. And here again, something else we got to remember, all of this happened before Jesus raised from the dead. In dark moments, these guys remained faithful. You know, I don't know why they remained faithful. I don't have an answer for you on that one. But I will say this. I bet it helped having someone on your side with you as you went through it. I don't know if Joseph could have done it alone. I don't know if Nicodemus could have done it alone. But there was power in numbers. You know, a fitting question at this time would be, who are you going to have with you when things seem difficult? But I think that question's too self-focused. I think a better question is, during this time, who are you going to be there for when things get difficult for them? Not looking at what you can bring to yourself, but looking outwards. Who can you go love and encourage? See, the title of my lesson today is Finding Easter. Finding requires you to get up and go. Finding requires you to get up and search. Not just invite people to yourself, but make the effort to run towards those who might be needing it the most. You know, and during this time, it's going to take creativity. It really will. But the important thing is having the heart to embrace those, especially those who are on the fringe and who will need it the most. You know, I want to finish up here with my egg story. You know, during the egg hunt, I did end up finding the egg that had some money in it. I was so excited. I gathered the rest of the eggs. I really didn't care from there on out which eggs I had in my basket, but I took my 10 eggs and I went back to where we started. Obviously, I opened the egg with what I thought was money in it first. You know, I didn't know what I was expecting to find, but before I opened this egg, I had dreams of like buying a new video game console. I thought there would be enough cash in this small plastic egg to where I could buy a new Nintendo 64 or whatever it was at the time. I opened the egg and discovered it was nothing more than a $1 bill, which I probably used at a later time to buy candy. Amen. But looking back, I wasn't sure if my strategy would work or not. Maybe instead of dollars, someone could have just put in a sticker and I'd have been hosed as I shook the egg. My lighter and quieter strategy would just fallen apart right there. But see, something I did learn in that moment, at least as I look back on it, is how much power there is when people have hope. When people have hope, they're willing to do crazy things like run around and shake eggs. But even greater than this, when people have hope, especially hope in God, the sky's the limit for them. You know, I don't know what these times are going to lead towards. I can't promise things I don't have an answer to. But what I am sure of is that God is in control. What I am sure of is that Jesus died for us and he rose from the grave just like he said he would. And for this reason, I know for me, I'm going to continue to have hope. A hope that's willing to joyfully seek Jesus in spite of any obstacles that could interfere. So here's my challenge to you. Don't lose hope. And don't ever stop running towards Jesus. For Mary, her searching led to learning how to treasure Jesus on a deeper level. For Joseph of Arimathea, he continued to search even after Jesus died, in large part because he had his friend Nicodemus. So for us, we should never give up moving towards Jesus because we have a Savior that is willing to give his life for us, and then he rose again on the third day. And this is the reason that we celebrate. Let's pray for communion. Father God, we are just so humbled by your Son and by your grace. God, we are so thankful for this opportunity to meet, even if it's online, God, but we're just so thankful for this opportunity to connect. God, we're also so grateful for hope. Hope that comes in the resurrection, hope that comes on Easter Sunday and every day because your Son did what he said he would do and he rose from the dead. God, we're so thankful for this opportunity. We're so thankful for the blood that was shed and the body that was broken. We love you and we're grateful. Pray in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen. Thanks so much for worshiping with us this morning. It's been a great time of hanging out, listening to Jeff Smith preach about finding Easter. And we want to thank you for worshiping with us as well. We pray that you'll have a great week this week worshiping God and just enjoy your time with your family as we go through these challenging times. We know that God's got our backs. He's taking care of us and he's got a plan for us. Amen. We're going to close out with one more song this morning. Jehovah, you are the Most High God.
All of the gods, they are the works of man. But you are the Most High God. And there is none like you. Jehovah, you are the Most High. You are the Most High God. Jehovah, you are the Most High. You are the Most High God. Jehovah, you are the Most High. You are the Most High God. Jehovah, you are the Most High.
exalted forever, God. Come on, right now, just all over the room, all over our campuses. Why don't we just begin to speak his name out loud? Come on, just call on his name. Declare that he's worthy. Declare that he's worthy. Begin to give him thanks, give him praise for what he's done. Speak the name of Jesus over your situation. Speak the name of Jesus over your circumstances. That in the name of Jesus, strongholds must come down. That in the name of Jesus, addiction is overcome. In the name of Jesus, healing is possible. Come on, just all over the room, call on the name of Jesus. Declare that his power, the power of Jesus is your inheritance. The grace of Jesus is your inheritance. The resurrection power of grace, Jesus, from the dead is yours. In Jesus' name, come on. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power.
Who could carry that kind is my tomb till I made. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb. Till I made. You call my name and I.